Now, C4.
And Brian Nehman.
WBAL News Radio 1090.
FM 101.5.
And the WBAL mobile app.
All right, Brian Nehman, C4 here on WBAL News Radio 1090 and FM 101.5. We're pleased to be joined now by the mayor of Baltimore, Brandon Scott. Good morning, Mr. Mayor. How are you?
Good morning, Brian. Good morning, C4. Good morning, gentlemen.
I know you you made a lot of news yesterday, so I want to get into all of that. I did have a question, though. I'm confused, and I think this is part of the problem why people are kind of frustrated about this. You mentioned yesterday that, you know, the city has gotten, I think you used the number 44,000 people vaccinated, and that includes the hospitals. The numbers that you're talking about in Baltimore City, do they include 44,000? Those are the only shots that have been given to the Baltimore City Health Department, or does that include the hospitals as well?
That number includes the hospitals, and as I said yesterday, the health department is about 20% of that, Brian. And I think that will have you recall the letter that I sent last week, and I want folks to hear this again because I know that you guys on your sister station on WLTV were talking about this. This issue is something that not just myself, but the county executives from around the state have been talking about as an issue where we as local governments, local health departments are getting our doses and being told week by week and sometimes as late as Friday or Saturday what you're getting for the next week. Whereas, these partners, private partners like the pharmacies can see 3 weeks out. And we also, inside the system that the state has, we're not allowed to able to access where and how many they've given out and who they've given it out to inside our own jurisdiction, which creates a lot of problems, which is why the frustration and why, you know, we're talking with the state about trying to focus more on the local health department, but also allow us the access so that we can see things that will allow us to have a better coordination.
But my confusion is that the University of Maryland Medical System said that they've already vaccinated 50,000 people. So if they've had 50,000, then that's higher than the 44 that you mentioned yesterday. I guess that's where my confusion is what's included in the city.
All of those people don't live here. You have to think about that. They have to vaccinate. They're vaccinating people from all over. And for example, this is another thing that the letter that I sent to the governor, even though, for example, we're running that big mass vac site down at the convention center. All of those people are not Baltimore City residents. That's why we asked for those to be, you know, have a specific amount of those dedicated to the people that live here because this is the jurisdiction in which they live. And I think that, again, that's part of the frustration you heard not just from me, from the county executives. You've heard our congressional delegation talk about these issues. We actually were on a call with Senator Van Hollen yesterday where one of the elected leaders from Caroline County talked about how Walmart there was giving doses out to people that live in Delaware. This is the issue around the state.
We're joined by Baltimore City Mayor Brandon Scott. It's a monthly opportunity to speak with the mayor. And Baltimore City Mayor, we noticed that you had moved the mass vaccination site for the city from Port Covington to BCCC. We actually had the president, McCurdy, on talking about it being there. You've also engaged with LifeBridge and MedStar Health and others to have this mobile health center. This is about getting right out to the people, right? Because at 3.4%, you said, of reaching African Americans, just not working with them coming to you, right?
Yeah, and it's about going to the folks that we need to get to, right? And when you talk about what the partnership that we announced yesterday with Dr. DeRosa, but also with our health partners, equity is going to remain at the center of our strategy. That includes taking special care of the older adults in our Black and brown communities who are more susceptible to the virus, who are the ones dying from the virus. And we're grateful to MedStar Health, LifeBridge, and Johns Hopkins. The first clinic took place, C4, on the 29th at Cherry Hill Senior Homes. And we're going to be going and targeting those places and folks, one, because they also can't get out as easy. You know, C4, you spend a lot of time going to those places. You know how it's difficult for them to transport themselves across town, even without focus of putting in a BCC, because it's next to Mondawmin, the biggest transit hub for us in the city that everyone can pretty much get to. But we still know we have folks who simply can't get out, and we're going to make sure and very grateful to our partners for allowing us to get to those seniors and into hard-to-reach places. places.
You know, the statewide numbers show that the African-American population is about 15% that have been vaccinated of all those who have been vaccinated. And if Baltimore is under 4%, what is the problem in Baltimore? Why aren't we higher than other places? Clearly, we're way behind if the statewide number is 15%.
Well, again, Bryan, this is the issue. I want to hear you out. Hear me out. When you look at what the health department, if the health department in Baltimore City is getting such a low number that their vaccination percentage is only 20% of what's been given out, and most of it has been given out by our partners, we know if you look at who works in some of these places, they're not African American by and large. And we also, that is the reason why I specifically wrote the letter and reached out to the governor first, by the way, and wrote a letter around centering equity, around setting aside, around allowing the local health department to get more of the doses, especially now with the federal government saying and President Biden saying they're going to be partnering with pharmacies. We need to allow local health departments to be the lead on this because they know how to reach individuals. They have the connections. They run clinics for flu vaccines. The problem here is two things. Two things. It's the rollout and it's the lack of vaccines that we had to administer to people.
All right. I'm sorry, C4. Maybe I'm slow on this, Mr. Mayor. I'm trying to figure it out because I'm trying to look at this. And you said 44, and I mentioned that Maryland has said that they've given 50,000 vaccinations out already. So you know that Hopkins has probably got the same amount of numbers. So that's where my confusion lies. I mean, if you do that, you're talking about well over 100,000 that's in Baltimore City. I know you say that they're
You're not thinking about it in the right way, Bryan. Again, they're giving it out. That's how many they've administered. That's not how many they administered to Baltimore City residents. They administered to all of their employees who some live in the county, some live in other counties. You have to think about that. That's what we're talking about here. And that's where you hit this frustration again, Bryan. It's not just a Baltimore City frustration. I know you saw what Anne Arundel County is saying now.
Yeah.
This is the frustration from all of us because we don't know who they're giving it to because we're not allowed to see exactly how and where it's going. And that's one of the biggest issues.
I know, but I guess my question is, do you know how many vaccinations have been given to the hospitals and Baltimore City? Do we have that number? That's what I need to know. Do we know that number?
That information, I don't know off the top of my head, but that information is given to us through the health commissioners were in our health department working with the hospitals. It's not something that you would think, right? You would think that, hey, we will be able to go in and say, okay, the health department from Baltimore City can go in and say, okay, they've given giant this amount of vaccines in Baltimore. They give this group this kind of vaccines in Baltimore. Our federally qualified health partners in Baltimore have gotten this many. That's not allowed. That's what one of the problems is. That's why you hear the frustration and asking for the access. And we'll be sure to send you a copy of the letter, Bryan, so that you can see it, that we want to be able to see that information. It should be that we automatically have the ability to look at it.
Yeah.
The system rollout is one of the functions with the issue that we have. But still, I also don't want you and I to argue ourselves in something that we agree on. But also, I want to also uplift again that the most important thing that you hear from me, that you hear from the county executives, that you hear from the governor, is there simply isn't enough vaccine.
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, I think that's the big problem, is that there's just not enough vaccines on it. But bottom line is, do you feel like Baltimore City has been shorted vaccines?
Well, I think that we should have. It's not about just being shorted vaccines. It's about having them delivered in the best and most equitable way. Do we think that we should have gotten more? Yes, but every jurisdiction thinks they should have gotten more. But I think it's about the access and to the information. It's about the coordination. And that's why I wrote a specific letter with specific requests to the governor in order for us to be able to have a more equitable distribution.
Baltimore City Mayor Brandon Scott is on board with us. Sorry about that, Mr. Mayor, for some technical difficulties. But when it comes to, you know, assistance for businesses, because at the same time you're trying to get needles in arms, you have announced last week a $3.9 million additional grant to restaurants and to folks. Talk about that, if you can, for a second.
Yeah, listen, we know that our restaurant industry, C4, is hurting, right? You know that We had already given out over $7 million, and now we're coming back with the second round made possible thanks to the great work by the federal government and down through the state in partnership. And we want folks to go out and go out and to apply for that as soon as they can. I'm going to give you the website in 1 second, but we want folks to go out and be able to get that information out, get those grants, get them into the hands of our restaurateurs who need it, because we know that they are the most hit, and we know the great work that has been happening across the city. BDC has done a great job in making sure that they're reaching folks. But if you simply go to BaltimoreTogether.com, they have a link for the COVID resources from BDC, and you can apply for the grants there. We want everyone to apply. The application is open, I believe, through the 19th of February. So please go and apply now.
Mr. Mayor, obviously, you know, crime is continuing to be a problem in the year 2021. I don't think anybody really expected it to go away. But what you have seen so far in some of the changes, have you, in the micro zones, have you seen anything that gives any kind of optimism that things are going to get, you're going to have traction regarding, you know, I guess we could call this a little bit of a new strategy or a changing a little bit of what we were doing before?
Well, Bryan, we're way too early to have any credible data on what's going on with the new microzone. So I like to let that play itself out and to have a time frame that is acceptable by our statisticians. But what I will say is this. While I'm still very unhappy that we are dead even where we were last year for homicides, even though we know that was lower than the year before, I am very appreciative, and I can see in the results some of the hard work and the changing of what's going on, right? I can see, for example, as you know, the police department for a long time in the previous administration wasn't really communicating about who we're looking for, how they're targeting people, and seeing them being able to go out and get one of those gentlemen who senselessly murdered a MTA mobility driver very quickly, and then looking for the next one very quickly, and some of the cases that they've been able to close very quickly when it comes to homicides and shooting and have suspects. I think right now they were talking about on you guys' sister station about four people that we're looking at, for most of them for shooting and homicides. That is encouraging me. The amount of guns that we're hearing and gun arrests that they're making and using the technology like light license plate reader units, that's encouraging to me. And we're not done making sure that we're working to get the changes there. And like I said, again, I am never going to accept that where we are is going to work. But at the same time, I can see some of the progress, especially when you think about robberies in the city of Baltimore, which are down significantly, down 31% from last year to this year. And when you think about, in particular, when you think about robberies of street on the street, carjackings, et cetera, are down 48%, which is a good sign. But we have a lot of work to do, Bryan, as you know, and we're going to continue to push on that front each and every day.
Baltimore City Mayor Brandon Scott is on board with us. And once again, on the issue of crime, Mr. Mayor, you know, last year COVID hit and we weren't able to really push this. But I talked about after the arrest. It's one thing to arrest individuals, particularly violent people. It's another thing to track it afterwards. Your mayor's coordinating council looking at this. Can you, by the end of this year, can we talk about looking at after they were arrested, how much time they got or how they went away? Because, you know, Mr. Mayor, it's repeat violent offenders we're dealing with.
Yeah, it is. And also, C4, as you know, this is something we talked about before. In my first meeting with the governor, I asked him, and this is something that he and I are going to be discussing, I know, because it's a priority for both he and I asked to restart the Criminal Justice Coordinating Committee out of my mayor's office of Neighborhood of Safety and Engagement, because you and I both know that has to happen. That accountability, and that's exactly what Director Jackson is going to do when we restart it. You'll hear from us in the coming weeks about how we're going to be working through doing that, and we will look at that. We will look at not just that, C4, not just when folks get sent to prison and things like that, but also looking and analyzing, well, why didn't this case, why was this case not prosecuted? What was the issue? What did BPD do wrong? How can we work with the state's attorney's office better to make a stronger case? What issue there may have been with that may have happened in the state's attorney, or what issue may have happened on the judiciary side, so
exactly.
that we all can have a constructive relationship, but you need the data and the analysis to do that, and you need all the partners at the table, because as you know, I can't make the state agencies do anything. So we have to have all that partnership. It is not about we have to get away from some of the things that happened in that group in the past where they're trying to blame it all on the state's attorney's office or blame it all on the judges or blame it all on the police department. It's about being constructively working together to make Baltimore a safer place. And that's how we are going to embark on that.
Quickly, I know you asked Johnson & Johnson for 300,000 vaccinations, and the governor said that's not going to happen. That's a quote from the governor. Do you agree on that assessment? What do you say to that?
Well, look, like I said yesterday, you'll know the quote. You take 100% of the shots, you miss 100% of the shots you don't take. And I'm grateful that the governor, again, has partnered and stood up the mass vac site in Baltimore City. We know that that's important. We had the big one a month before that. But we need stronger partnership and coordination to ensure that the rollout is equitable. And I think that it would be a travesty if the Johnson & Johnson vaccine that's made here in Baltimore City didn't directly benefit those people here in Baltimore City. So that's what I have to say about that.
Well, Mr. Mayor, we always appreciate your time. And maybe next time that we talk, we can figure out how these health trucks are doing going into neighborhoods and the success that you're finding actually getting needles in the arm, taking the needles to the people as opposed to the other way around, Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, gentlemen.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Appreciate your time, as always.
Mayor of the City of Baltimore, Brandon Scott.